So thanks for praying for my mother and father-in-law big time. I really appreciate that. We went down last weekend to spend some time with them, and just continue to pray for them if you would. And thank you so much for being a part of our services. And boy, wasn't it awesome to hear Pastor Tim last weekend? He just blew it up, did an awesome job. And that's my little brother, so from the same mother. But anyway, so we've been talking about work, and because it's a third of our lives, and since it's a third of our lives, and since it's such a huge part of our lives, we recognize that God has a plan for it, and God has a purpose for it. There is a purpose in your profession, and part of that is submitting to authority, and that's never fun, but that's part of something that we have to do, and the reason is because we're always going to have authority in our life, always. And it's important to learn that lesson early, because if you learn it early, you save yourself a whole lot of heartache, because we all have a rebellious streak in us. Can I get a testimony? Yeah. I mean, we all do, right? I mean, we all want to go at times against authority. But the Bible says to submit to authority, and it doesn't mean that we trust it, and it doesn't mean that we always agree with it, and it doesn't mean that authority always does the right thing, because authority doesn't always do the right thing. But the Bible gives us, God gives us a verse in His Word that helps us kind of bridge that gap between a lack of trust and that obedience to be able to submit to authority no matter what. And it's an amazing verse. Romans chapter 13 and verse number 1 says this, everyone must submit himself to the governing authorities, for there's no authority except that which God has established. And so what God says is this, every time you submit to authority, it may not be something you want to do, but every time you do it, what you're really saying is this, God, I trust you. Because God is the one that has placed the authority in the position where they are. And so every time we submit to authority, in a sense, really what we're doing is trusting God. Now, when it comes to work, we have a boss. Most every one of us have a boss. And sometimes we get good bosses, and sometimes we get bad bosses. We all know that. I mean, that's just part of life. I remember that I used to work for this store called Carlin's Men's Store at Fair Oaks Mall. And you have to be a person from around here to know that store, because it was back in the 80s when it was open. But I remember one time, and I don't mean to offend anybody with what I'm about to say, but I'm just going to tell you, if you want to cover your ears, you can. My boss was in the bathroom, and he clogged up the toilet. That's a fun thing to talk about on Sunday morning, isn't it? But what was terrible about it was when he came out of the bathroom, he looked at me and said, I clogged up the toilet. Barry, you need to fix it. And he just walked out. I think the first thing out of my mouth was, really? And then the second thing I did was, I did the job. And I will never be able to erase some of those sights that I saw that day. I will never be able to escape the smells that I smelled that day. And the only reason I tell you that story is because sometimes you just get a bad boss. And I know what it's like. And sometimes you get a really good boss, you know. I remember when I worked for Superior Paving, the foreman on our asphalt crew, I was talking to him one day about the fact that my brakes weren't working. And he said, hey, you get the parts. Maybe one day next week after work, we'll work on your car and fix your car. And I was like, really? He goes, yeah. I said, thank you so much. That is awesome. And I'll tell you something. After you've done a day in the summer working with asphalt, the last thing you want to do is another job at the end of the day. You're done. And trust me, I know, because I've been on asphalt crews. But at the end of the day, I said, hey, William, I got the parts. He's like, great. Let's fix your car. So literally after all that hard work, all that day, he was, you know, under this little light on the back of the shop in at the plant in Centerville. We had my car jacked up underneath this light, and we were working on my car, fixing my car. And I will never forget him going the extra mile and helping me, you know, fix my car. As a matter of fact, one of the first things that I did when our family came back here to join the team to plant Park Valley Church, Bob Surface came up to me and he said, hey, Barry, I want you to know your old boss, William, I asked him to come to my office. And the reason I asked him to come to my office is because he's fighting cancer right now, and I don't know if he has Jesus in his heart. So Bob and me and William, my old boss, who came in with a cane, as weak as can be, and he sat down in the chair, and we shared Jesus Christ with him. and he bowed his head and he prayed and accepted Jesus right there in the office. 2 weeks later, he went home to be with the Lord. And you know, the amazing thing about that is sometimes you get good bosses and sometimes you get bad bosses, and sometimes there's opportunities to have relationship with bosses that maybe go way beyond just work, you know, and we have to understand that whoever it is that's there, God has put him there for a reason. So there's this verse that helps us with this whole thing, you know, connecting with our boss and having the right kind of relationship with our boss. It's found in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse number 5. And by the way, you know what I love about the Bible? What I love about Christianity and living by God's word is God is always a part, basically, of everything in our lives that are difficult. Everything in our lives that we do that really we can't possibly do in and of ourselves, you'll always find God in the scripture, or God is a part of it. Like when it comes to submitting to authority, God says, yes, submit to authority. But then he says, I want you to know that I'm all around it. I'm the one that placed authority there. So he's in the middle of it. God's with God at the center of your life, you can do things that seem impossible. You can do things that are very difficult to do. Same thing with the boss. It's like he says, look, I know you may have a challenging boss. Look, I get that. But what you have to understand is that when you serve and when you work hard and when you do your job with enthusiasm and when you do it with excellence, you're doing it for me. That's what God says. God's always at the center of every difficult thing that we need to do, and he makes it palatable. He makes it, you know, doable. Same thing with the relationship with your boss. Ephesians chapter 6 and verse number 5, he says, slaves, or if we could, you know, just maybe even apply it to our situation and say, you know, employees, make sure that you obey your earthly employers with deep respect and fear and serve them sincerely as you would serve Christ. In other words, Christ is your real boss. So we've said before, if you make hamburgers for a living, make a burger for Jesus. You know, sell insurance for Jesus. I always say, make a burger that would make Jesus' mouth water. You know, sell insurance for Jesus, because in a few verses, the Bible lets the cat out of the bag and says, trust me, Jesus or the Lord is the one who will reward you. It doesn't matter who your boss is. It doesn't matter what company you work for. All the rewards and all the promotions and all the raises, they're all in the hands of Jesus. So you serve him as if he is your boss. Verse 6, work hard. Now, how many of you believe it's okay to work hard? All the teenagers go, I'm going to tell you something. There ain't nothing wrong with hard work. I'm going to talk about that in just a minute. It says, not just to please your masters when they're watching, but as slaves of Christ, do the will of God with all your heart. And then it says, work with enthusiasm. That's an attitude thing. Hey, we can be doing things on the outside, but not doing it on the inside. It's like I'm, you know, it's just easy to have the wrong kind of attitude, especially when it comes to our work. God says, when you do this work, make sure that you do it with enthusiasm as though you're working for the Lord rather than for people. Verse 8, why? Because he's the one that gives you the reward. Again, in his hand are the promotions. In his hand is the money. In his hand are all the ideas and all the success and all the relationships and all the connections and all the sales. It's all in his hands. He is the one who will reward you. You work with enthusiasm as though you were working for him. You submit to your boss. Why? Because he's the one who placed him or her there in your life. Verse number 9, it says, in the same way, he flips it around and he talks to the bosses. He says, hey, bosses, you better treat your employees right. Do not threaten them. Remember, you both have the same master in heaven, and he doesn't play any favorites. I love that. I love the way he just flips it right around and says, here's the relationship between a boss, an employer, and an employee. And it's amazing. I guess after I read a verse like that, what I'm trying to think is this. It's probably just good, before we throw in the towel on the job that God has given us and the boss that God has placed over us and all the coworkers that God has placed around us for a reason, I think it's good to ask, even in the middle of a challenge, what can I do to push through? What can I do to be faithful? What can I do to hang in there and not quit? What could I do to stay here? I just think it's a good question to ask, even if you have a tough boss. Now, I was thinking about in the Bible of a person who had a tough boss, and I thought about Jacob. Jacob had a really rotten boss, and his boss was Uncle Laban, right? Of Laban Enterprises or whatever. And you know, so Jacob worked for Laban, and Jacob had to work 7 years for his first wife, Leah, which, by the way, he thought he was getting Rachel. And it didn't work out that way. Okay, he got the old switcheroo done on him, you know. I don't know, who has had that happen when you married the wrong woman? No, I'm just kidding. That would be interesting. You wake up in the morning, who are you? Well, that's basically what happened with Jacob. He had the whole switcheroo done on him. Instead of getting Rachel, he got Leah. And if your name's Leah, I apologize, but you're probably an awesome person. It's just that he didn't love her, that's all. And he ended up with Leah. And so Laban came back and said, okay, if you want Rachel, you got to work another 7. So he worked 14 years for Rachel, his wife. 14 years. I mean, that's a lot of work. So basically, Jacob is saying this. It's okay to work hard. It's okay to have a good work ethic. It's okay to work hard for the things that you truly value in life. And I think that's just a good lesson to learn. Now, when I say it's okay to work hard, I'm not talking about worshiping work. I'm not talking about elevating it above your God. I'm not talking about using your work to be able to escape responsibilities that you have at your home. I'm not thinking, hey, honey, I got to work late again. I'm not going to be able to change diapers and wipe snotty noses and do baths and whatever. I got to stay here and work. Yeah, baby. I'm not talking about that. I'm not talking about elevating accomplishments above relationships. I'm not talking about any of that. I'm just talking about old-fashioned, good old hard work. You know, a person that says, I'm going to use my time wisely. I'm going to prioritize my tasks. I'm going to stay busy. I'm going to do a job with excellence. My first job, I was a junior in high school, and I worked at McDonald's. How many of you, that was your first job? Raise it up, McDonald's. Wow, not many. I thought that was a lot of people's first job. Well, it was mine, and I can tell you this, I loved it. That polyester uniform, that greasy film all over my body. Oh, it was good. See, I worked on the grill, and I made hamburgers and quarter pounders, Big Macs. I mean, it was a dream. And but the crazy thing about it was this. The restaurant wasn't always busy. There were times when we were slow. And when we were slow, I'd be back in the grill. I'd just be kind of leaning back on the grill, just chilling. And every once in a while, the manager would come back and look at me right in the face, and she would say this. If there's time to lean, oh, you know. You said you didn't work at McDonald's. That's like McDonald's DNA. If there's time to lean, there's time to clean. What was she basically telling me? She was telling me this. You need to stay busy. We are paying you money to be here. Not to lean, but to clean. And to make burgers. And to work hard. And to use your time wisely. And it's funny because in those first jobs that you get a lot of times in your life, you start learning those principles in life that you need to work hard and you need to stay busy. Christine and I got married. She was 20 years old. I was 21. We didn't have a plan B when it came to, we didn't have any other source of income other than ourselves. We were married. We were on our own. We had to come up with the money for our rent. We had to come up with money for food and clothing and cars and all those things. And I was joking around. One of the first cars that we had was a Plymouth Volare, and it was rusted out horribly. The radio was great, but it was just rust was terrible all over. And I literally, every time it rained, I had to open up the hood, take off the distributor cap, dry it off with a towel so that the car would start. And I mean, it was just those early days, you know, but all through those types of things, what do you learn to do? You learn to work. What did my wife do? She quit school, got a full-time job so we could eat. Eating comes in handy. And I went to school full-time, and I worked nights as a waiter and weekends as a waiter at a restaurant called Shakers in Lynchburg. And it was a new restaurant at the time. And I enjoyed working there, and I enjoyed going to school. And every once in a while, we would get seasonal work with UPS during Christmas. And we would wash trucks and work on the conveyor belt and have somebody yell and scream at you and you know, all that fun stuff. Why? You know why? Because it's okay to work hard. And at the end of the day, when you work hard, a couple of things happen. Number one, I think it humbles you. And number two, I think you begin to appreciate the things that you have in life. And it's fulfilling. It's fulfilling to be able to do something to where you can provide for the needs of your wife, needs of your husband, needs of your children, you know, whatever it may be. It's just a fulfilling thing to make a contribution with your life. And at the end of the day, know that you worked hard. So Jacob worked hard. And even though he worked hard, he had a really, really, really rotten boss. And the thing about Jacob was he was honorable, he was trustworthy, he was faithful in his employment with Laban. Because the Bible says he never ever took one of Laban's animals, not one, in the entire 20 years that he worked for Laban. He didn't take one, and he could have done it because it would have been his right to be able to take from some of the flock and feed himself and feed his family. But Jacob always provided for his own needs, always. Jacob always took care of his own needs, and he was honorable to his employer. And, you know, the crazy thing about it was at the end of the 20 years that he worked for him, he finally said, I'm out of here. And he got his family, and he left basically in the night. And Laban chased after him and caught up to him, and they had this one-on-one conversation that was very, you know, transparent, we'll say. And basically, Jacob unloaded on his rotten, stinking, you know, unethical, unfair boss, father-in-law boss of 20 years. And this is what he says to him in Genesis chapter 31 and verse 38. I love it. He just starts off by saying this, 20 years. 20 years, Laban. I love that. 20 years I've been with you. And all the time, I've cared for your sheep and your goats so that they would produce healthy offspring. And in all those years, I never touched a single ram of yours for food. Never. Not one, you know. If they were attacked and killed by wild animals, did I show them to you? Did I ask you to reduce the count of the flock? No. I took the loss, Laban, for 20 years. You made me pay for every single animal that was stolen, whether it was my whether the loss was my fault or not. I worked through the scorching heat of the day, through the cold and sleepless nights, 20 years, 14 of them earning your daughters, two daughters, 6 years to try to get the flock that I have here. And you reduced my wages 10 times. I mean, most of the time when you're with a company for 20 years, you get a pay raise at some point, don't you? Jacob got pay reductions. Every time. I mean, really? What kind of a boss does that and treats him the way he did? All I'm saying is this. When you read the narrative and the way that Jacob was a faithful and hard and trustworthy and honorable worker for a boss who, quite frankly, was unethical and a jerk, what you realize anyway is that no matter how cruel Laban was, no matter how many times he lowered his pay, no matter how many times he cheated him out of something for his family, God blessed Jacob anyway. He blessed him every single step of the way because God is the one that is in charge of all of these things, all of these blessings, all of these pay raises, and that's exactly what God did for Jacob. So I guess the question today is this. How do you stay faithful when your boss is, you know, I guess kind of a jerk? Probably not a good word to say. I don't know. But how do you stay faithful in a job when your boss is such a challenge? Now, the first thing you need to do is this. There's four quick things. Number one, I believe it's important for you to have a healthy opinion of yourself. I do. And that sounds kind of weird or whatever, but I think there's a reason why God teaches us in his word that when he made us as masterpieces. I think there's a reason why in Psalm 139, the Bible says that every single one of us in this room have been woven together and knit together like an intricate and fine work of art, like a masterpiece, like a tapestry, right down to the smallest thread, right down to the smallest element of who you are. God designed you exactly the way you are, and whatever God makes is wonderful. God doesn't make mistakes, and God doesn't make junk. God makes masterpieces, and God made you, and that's exactly what you are. And I just think to have that kind of to understand that truth and that reality about yourself, I think it's something that helps you through a bad boss or a challenging time at work. Now, has God made you a masterpiece? Absolutely. But when God made you, what did he make you from? He made you out of dust. We're created from dust. So to understand that I'm a masterpiece encourages me. To understand that God made me and shaped me and formed me and breathed life into me as dust is something that humbles me. And I think it's important to have a balance. A balance of, hey, looking at a, I mean, you wouldn't walk into work going, masterpiece just walked up in the house. You wouldn't do that because that's weird. There's a balance between, yes, you're a masterpiece. Walk confidently in who you are, but you're also made from dust. And we are to be humble. And when the glory is given out, it goes to God. And when the credit gives out, it goes to God. And when the praise goes out, it goes to God. That's why anytime somebody praises you or gives you glory, you become bashful and it becomes weird. It becomes awkward. When somebody's looking at you going, you're amazing, you're incredible, you're awesome, you're going, it's enough. Shh. That's why when everybody's going, they're clapping for you and you're walking out, they're going, okay, that's enough clapping. Have a seat, you know, whatever. Why? Because when you were made, you weren't made to receive glory, you were made to give glory. You were made to give glory to the one who made you from dust. But when he made you from dust, he made you a masterpiece. And so I just say, you know, walk with that into work, you know, on a regular basis. In Jacob's case, you know, his mom, Rachel, she wasn't able to have kids. So because of that, we see a verse in Genesis 25, 21. Isaac prayed to the Lord on behalf of his wife. Isaac prayed to the Lord on behalf of his wife. It's an easy verse to memorize. Isaac prayed to the Lord on behalf of his wife. I think all of us as husbands ought to pray to the Lord on behalf of our wives. And in order to do that, she's got to be number one on the top of your prayer list. And you've got to dwell with her according to understanding and knowledge to know what it is and what her needs are and what her greatest challenges are in her life so that you can pray for her. And that's what Isaac did. And did you know that God had the audacity to answer his prayer? God answered his prayer because Rebecca basically comes back to Isaac and says this, you're not going to believe this, but I think I'm pregnant. After all that had transpired, after the hurt that Rebecca went through, after all the times that Isaac had poured his heart out to God and begged God, please give her kids, please give her kids. She comes back and says she's pregnant. How do you think those two parents view those two kids? Because she had twins, by the way, Jacob and Esau. How do you think those parents viewed those kids? I'll tell you what, probably a day didn't go by that they didn't look into their faces and say this, guys, look at me. Jacob, look at me. Esau, come on, Mr. Harry, look at me. You guys are an answer to prayer. You are our little miracles. How many times do you have to hear that from a parent? That kind of gives you an idea that it's okay that you could have a good opinion of yourself because you're nothing but a miracle of God. And you're nothing but, you know, an answer to prayer because that's what you are in reality. And if anybody ever comes up to you and says, hey, how you doing? My little accident. Can I just say this? It isn't true. It isn't true. You're not an accident because all life is ordained by God. All life is ordained by God. And he knew about you and he planned you. You are an answer to prayer and you are a masterpiece and you are God's little miracle. So I say go in and walk up to your boss and say, hi, I'm an answer to prayer. I'll be over here, you know, or whatever. I don't know. The second thing is this, have confidence in how God made you. And by the way, can I say this? Having confidence in how God made you is not a license to sin. In other words, you can't walk up to somebody and say, well, it's just how God made me. Deal. He gave me a short fuse, so I'm allowed to throw stuff and pretend like I'm going to hit people. I don't think so. I don't think that gives you a license or me a license to say, hey, that's how God made me. Don't blame God for that. Don't blame God for our sin. But there are a whole lot of ways that we are unique because no two people on this planet are alike. God loves variety, and he has made every single one of us different. And in the passions that he has given you and in the interests that he has given you and the talents that he has given you, he has set you up to be able to be productive for him and to advance the kingdom of God with the way that he has made you uniquely. Jacob and Esau were twins. Jacob and Esau were brothers, and yet they were literally night and day. Genesis 25, 27 says the boys grew up and Esau became a skillful hunter and a man in open fields. Literally, if you read about him, literally when the day he came out of his mommy, they looked at him and said, "Does he have a fur coat on?" "No, he's just hairy. He just got a lot of hair." Looked like he had a fur coat on as an infant. That's a hairy kid. But that's how he was, you know. And the Bible says that he was a skillful hunter and that he was a man of the open fields. On the other hand, Jacob, he was the kind of person that just liked to stay home. So Isaac really kind of liked Esau, and Rebekah really kind of favored Jacob. And so they were just different. Esau was hairy, and Jacob was smooth. And Esau loved the outdoors. That's what it says. And Jacob was smooth. Esau loved the outdoors, and Jacob loved to just kind of stay home. Esau loved to go out and kill food, and Jacob loved to cook food. And that's cool. Whatever. All I'm saying is, one of the most liberating things that you will ever go through in your life is to be comfortable in your own skin. I'm in my late 40s for the next few days. So I'm holding on to that. But, I mean, even though I'm just about 50 years old, I think I've always struggled with that whole thing about being comfortable in my own skin. And I know that's kind of weird to say and transparent and blah, 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 whatever. But I think it can be a very liberating thing to be okay with the way God made you and to realize that you can be used of God to do absolutely amazing things for the kingdom of God. And I told you about the time that I went to Quicksilver in Laguna Beach, California. We were out there on a trip, and my son comes running out of the store, and he goes, "Dad, Brady Quinn is in the store right now." Brady Quinn, quarterback of the Cleveland Browns. So I walked in there, and I'm looking at the guy, and I'm thinking, dude is 6'6" and jacked, chiseled out of stone. That's what I'm thinking, and I'm just kind of going through the shirts, like I'm looking at the shirts, but I'm just looking at him going, I mean, he's got like perfect skin and perfect face and perfect hair and just perfect. Looks like a Roman statue. So I'm thinking to myself, I'm going to go up and ask him for a picture. And I hope he is a jerk. I hope he is. There's got to be something about this guy that's just terrible. So I walked up to him and I said, "Hey, Mr. Quinn, can we have a picture?" He's like, he smiles, and this tooth just goes, ding. He goes, "Of course you can. Everyone in, close." And of course, I'm like, "Of course, he's nice." You know, every time he went out on the field and played for Cleveland and threw an interception, I took a little bit of pleasure in that. I really did. I was like, "Oh, way to go, Brady. You stink." All I'm saying is this. Just to get into that whole thing of comparing yourself with other people is a trap. It really is. Because, you know, we always say this at our church. There's only two things that can happen. You can either get really, really discouraged because you think everybody's better than you, or you can get caught up in pride because you think you're better than everyone else. And that's pretty much the only two things. I mean, you don't look around and say, "Everyone's equal." No one says that. We're all equal. We're all the same. No, we judge everyone, and you're better, and I'm better, and blah, blah, blah. And it just leads to those types of things. All I'm just trying to say is this. You know, if you have a job with a challenging boss, you know, walk into that place thinking, "God has made me the way he has made me, and I'm okay with that." And I think it's something that'll lead to your confidence. Third thing is this, be faithful in times of famine, because not everything is going to work out for you. You're going to have lean times at work. You are. It's just the way it's going to be. You're not always going to make the sale, you know, and sometimes you're going to lose a client. And sometimes you're going to do something, you know, stupid or whatever, and it's going to cause problems. You're going to make mistakes and those types of things. Sometimes your boss is going to come in and be insensitive insensitive to you or hurt you in some way, shape, or form. And you're going to face challenges. You're going to hit roadblocks in work. It's just going to happen. But I don't think that's the time to just say, hey, I hit a challenge, I'm out. I think sometimes God wants us to be faithful in the middle of the famine. And the same thing happened to Isaac, Genesis chapter 26. Got to remember, there's a little kid named Jacob walking around learning from his dad and watching his father and developing some principles and some character traits in him that is going to take into Laban Enterprises a little bit later on in his life. Genesis chapter 26 and verse 1, now a severe famine struck the land, as it happened just like with Abraham's time. So Isaac moved to Gerar, where Abimelech, king of the Philistines, lived. And the Lord appeared to him there and said, do not go to Egypt. I know it's going to be tempting to go to Egypt. I know things are tough right now, but don't go to Egypt. Verse 3, do as I say, stay here in this land, and if you do, I'm going to be with you. I'm going to bless you. I'm going to give this land to you and to your descendants, just as I solemnly promised Abraham your father. I love 26:6. It's a very simple phrase. It just says this. It just says, so Isaac stayed. He obeyed God. He obeyed God. He did what God told him to do. And in verse number 12, what did God do? That year, Isaac's crops were tremendous, even in the middle of a famine. He harvested 100 times more grain than he had planted, even in the middle of a famine. The Lord blessed him, even in the middle of a famine. He became rich, even in the middle of a famine. His wealth continued to grow and grow and grow, even in the middle of a famine. How many of you believe that God can bless you, even in the middle of a famine? Raise it up. I'm telling you, he can. Man, the temptation is to say, hey, we got a famine all up in here. I'm out. When really, God may be growing you, and God may be challenging you to stay faithful in the middle of a famine, because that's the temptation, especially when it comes to a bad boss. You reach a bad boss and you go, oh, this isn't going to work. I can tell you right now, this ain't going to work. I want you to watch this story.
So we've all had this boss, a boss that really gave us a tough time in life. Whether you're younger or older, you worked 2 years, 30 years, we've all had a boss that just really gave us the business, right? And so I had a boss a few years ago that I really wanted to get away from. And this boss was very difficult to work with, hard on the employees. And I kept praying. I prayed for probably 3 months, praying that God would show me a new job and get me out of the building, so to speak. And so as hard as I was praying to get me out, nothing was happening. And eventually I kind of reversed my praying and realized that this was really God's will needed to be done. And in this case, what God did for me, as I continued to pray, but pray differently, what God did for me was to help me move that person out. So that person actually left the company, which cleared the way for me to have a new boss, much better relationship. But at the time, I didn't really understand why God wouldn't help me find that new job. And so I work with three people in my group that are all self-proclaimed atheists. And so I realized after a period of time that what God really wanted me to do was for me to stay. He helped me solve my problem by moving my very difficult boss out of the mix. And what God wanted me to do was stay and try to talk to those three folks who were admittedly, to me, atheists. I have a Bible on my desk, so they knew that I was a Christian. We talked about things occasionally, but the reality is that they weren't receptive. One day, one of these three employees had some illness with their child, and I mentioned to the manager on the way out of the door, I said, I'll pray for you and your family. And his reply to me was, no thanks. So a couple weeks go by, and that child was still having some problems, still having some issues, and I mentioned again, I'd like to pray for you and your family, pray for your daughter to get well. And he became more receptive and said, I appreciate that. And so it eventually led to us sitting down and actually discussing things in the Bible, why it's important, why God is important. And I realized at the time that here I'd put all my focus on getting me out of the situation, and the reality was that God wanted me there for a very specific reason so that I could help witness to three other individuals. I've reached two of those individuals, pretty good so far. More work to be done, but the fact that we've gone from don't pray for me to accepting that I'm going to pray for you and being open to discussing Christ and God was a pretty big step. And so for me, just knowing that I had prayed for the wrong things up front, I thought moving me out was the right thing to do. All along, God wanted me there. And so God fixed my very difficult situation and helped me do witness for Him as well.
The last point is this: just keep digging. Just keep digging. Just keep fighting. Be generous and patient, even though somebody wants to oppose you. Be generous and patient, even though somebody wants to argue with you or fight with you or whatever it may be. You know, I think about Isaac, and, you know, he had dug a well, and at the bottom of that well, they hit a gusher. And I mean, it was a generous, gushing spring. And it was a success, and I'm sure they were very excited about all their hard work paying off. And then it wasn't long after all that hard work paid off and they had that success of that gushing spring that some people came along and said this: hey, that's ours. That's our water. Some people came along after they did all the hard work and tried to take their hard work away from them and try to take their success away from them. Maybe you have felt like that at work before, where you've done something and been successful, and maybe a boss took credit for what you did, or whatever it may be, or another employee, or whatever. And it's frustrating, to say the least, because it doesn't seem fair. It's amazing what Isaac did. The Bible says in chapter 26 and verse 20, but then the local shepherds came and claimed this spring. This is our water, they said. And they argued over it with Isaac's herdsmen. So Isaac named the well Argument. It's kind of cool. I like that. Well, I don't know. It's just cool. Because obviously they had argued with him about it. So what do? Do they stand there and argue with them? No. The Bible says they go off and they go dig another well. They just kept digging. Even though they wanted to argue, even though they wanted to oppose them, they just kept digging. Verse 21, Isaac's men dug another well. But again, there was a fight over it. So Isaac named that well Opposition. So they abandoned that well. They said, fine, you want the well? Go ahead and take the well. They went and dug another well. And the local people finally left him alone. So Isaac called it Room Enough. For he said, at last the Lord has made room for us, and we will be able to thrive. I love that statement. The reason I love that statement is because it's kind of like Isaac is saying this: it's going to take a whole lot more than an argument for you to drive me away. It's going to take a whole lot more than you standing up and opposing me to drive me away. As far as I'm concerned, you want that well, you take that well. I'm just going to keep digging. And I believe, and I will operate under this basis: we will thrive here, period. I love that. We will thrive here, period. And I think that ought to be our philosophy too when it comes to the jobs and the positions that God has given us. And, you know, the best way to overcome opposition is to outlast it and outlove it. And that's exactly what Isaac did. He obviously outlasted it because they got tired of coming and taking his wells. They didn't show up for the third one. Not to mention he outloved them because he just gave away all of that work and all of that success that he had to these other people and these other shepherds. And he said, fine, you go ahead and take it. I guarantee you this: the best way to overcome opposition is to outlove it and outlast it. Albert Einstein said these words. He said, great spirits have always encountered violent opposition from mediocre minds. And I honestly believe that's the truth. And I think what we need to do is just stand up and say, hey, this is where God has placed me. I will thrive here. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes for just a minute? If you're here this morning and you've never accepted Christ as your Savior, can I just tell you a very simple story? The simple story is that God became a human being and he came to this earth. And the reason he did that was not to rule and reign as a king. He could have done that. That would have been simple. Instead, what he did was, is he decided to, and it just boggles my mind that God could be an embryo, that God could be in a human body, that God could even be contained on this earth, and that God could allow somebody to punch him in the face and whip his back and nail him to a cross. And all of that is mind-boggling. It's a miracle beyond miracles. But in doing this, the blameless, spotless Lamb of God, the Son of God, literally took your sin and my sin in his own body. He paid for our sin. And when he did that, he took away the only thing that stands in between you and a relationship with the God who made you. You crave a relationship with him. You say, what do you mean? I don't even believe in him. Oh, even though you think you don't believe in him, you crave him. And I'm not trying to be a know-it-all because I know zippo. All I'm saying is I know and I believe the Bible to be true that you are a masterpiece made by God and you crave a relationship with him. And you're separated from him because of sin. And Jesus came to take care of that separation and be a bridge to the God you desperately crave. And if you will believe and accept what Jesus did for you 2,000 years ago, he'll change your life. He'll save you. He'll make you a part of his family right here, right now, today. If you'd like to pray and accept Christ as your Savior, why don't you pray something like this right now? Dear Heavenly Father, I want you to know that I believe. I believe. I believe that Jesus died on the cross for my sins, and I believe that 3 days later he rose from the dead for me. Thank you for saving me because of my faith in you. Help me, Lord, to live for you. Please wash me clean of my sins. Please take that burden of guilt off my back, and please make me a part of your family. I believe in you. I accept you. I receive you as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name I pray. With heads bowed and eyes closed.